Welcome to another Quick and Dirty Review. I'm Joe.
I'm Faust.
And we're reviewing...
Transformers 5, The Last Night.
I thought it was called A Flaming Pile of Trash.
Well, that's what we called it after we saw it.
Oh, okay. So first off, let's put a disclaimer.
Well, let's start it off and basically get it out of the way for the people who don't want to hear this. It stinks. It's a Transformers movie. It's the fifth Transformers movie, and there's a sequel hook. That's all I'm really going to put up there. But now, spoilers, because we really want to rip it to shreds.
Not to mention, we also saw it in 3D, which migraine central.
I will have to say that I am kind of biased because while this movie was horrible, it also physically assaulted me while being horrible.
Yeah.
So, you know, I might be a little bit more salty about it this time.
Okay, but I will say this. Michael Bay, this is the only good thing you're going to probably hear about the movie from me. Michael Bay has always tried to be on the bleeding edge technology for anything he walks in. IMAX was one of his original babies, which I totally was okay with. And that was a big change and move up. He filmed this 100% with 3D IMAX 70mm cameras.
Okay.
And so that's the only good part for me. So, again, spoiler warning, close this now if you don't want to see it. Holy crap!
My God, this movie. Now, granted, I stopped watching Transformers movies after the second or third one.
Second one.
I stopped watching after the second one, so they got rid of Mr. Witwicky.
Okay, but they did move him in with Anthony Hopkins' character and did tie him into a whole, like, secret brotherhood of understanding the Transformers.
Yeah, so apparently Anthony Hopkins is like the last of a line of what's known as the Witwickens, who are the line of people who have been going on since the days of Merlin and Arthur.
Merlin was played by Stanley Tucci, which was redeeming but not redeeming.
It was an absolute waste of Stanley Tucci. They wasted Stanley Tucci. I'm glad they let Anthony Hopkins have some fun with it.
Yes, Anthony Hopkins' character was excellently eccentric.
Mark Wahlberg is there as Cade Yeager. He's back again, but he still does Mark Wahlberg doing Mark Wahlberg in a Mark Wahlberg thing.
Okay, so wait, are we talking like the flexing and like...
No, that's Marky Mark.
Oh, okay.
This is not a Marky Mark thing. This is a Mark Wahlberg thing.
Okay.
Josh Duhamel is back as Colonel William Lennox, so he's still
around. His character was strong. It's always been strong, but when you're in a pile of bad movie, it doesn't matter how strong your character is, it's still crap.
And then Isabella Moner, as Isabella, comes in as sort of a child angle so that they can merchandise.
Definitely.
And I think she really kind of did a good job.
Right, but okay, big rumor mill going around. They're like, well, Megan Fox looks really different in this movie.
It's because it's not Megan Fox.
It's not Megan Fox.
You dinks.
Okay,
it's Laura Haddock.
Yeah, and she does okay. Like, she's not horrible, but she plays a sassy British chick, which they're either going to be dull or they're going to be sassy British ladies. There's really no in between.
Unfortunately, typecasting in the worst fucking way. And really, fuck this movie.
Yeah, no. Okay.
And so all of these people are really good or decent actors coming in and doing what they can, but it's the source material that
explosions.
And, you know, yes, you can have the most cutting edge technology out there, but if all you're doing is putting into the hands of somebody with Parkinson's and they're just shaking the shit out of the camera for the whole damn time, and then you shoot these really complex robots and really complex sequences, and you can't tell what the hell's going on for half of the time, and on top of that you're doing it in 3D, which I will admit physically assaults me because my eyes were so sore I didn't realize how much they were hurting until I left the theater to use the bathroom.
And their glasses, why can't you come up with a pair of 3D glasses that don't sit there and squeeze your temples for 95 minutes until you pull them off in the middle of the movie and go, it's all blurry? Well, no crap, it's all blurry. It's 3D, but it's just like it pushes right here. Make some normal fucking 3D glasses. Are they too hard to make like this? Make them like this and stop it.
Yeah. I'd even say, you know what, if I'm going to have to be forced to go see 3D movies, I would pay for a pair of prescription 3D glasses.
Yeah, not to mention, also, why not do the old man wraparound ones that cost nothing, if you're talking about cost?
Oh, you mean the kind that they give you for having your eyes dilated?
Yes!
Yeah, I would probably use those over the piece of craps that they give you at the theater. Oh. So, you know, there's the technology out of the way. They're saying that the actors did all right with what they were given, but what they were given was an absolute steaming pile. And
they need to stop.
I'm gonna spoil it. The big reveal right here and now. The major thing that's going on here that everybody who's a Transformer fan in even the smallest way is going to hate. Earth is Unicron.
What?
Fuck you, Michael Bay. You're fucking dead to me. You just raped my childhood. My Unicron is not. It can never be fucking Earth. Fuck you. Fuck you.
But wait a second. There's more. Just wait. So here's the kick. Earth is Unicron, right? Everybody knows Earth is Unicron now. Because guess what? There's also six horns that come out of Unicron that let Cybertron drain all the energy from Unicron and absorb it to rebirth Cybertron. This is just shit, people. Come on.
Unicron destroys Cybertron. Did you not read the source material?
So, I mean, okay, that... And then, okay, then they've got the Great Deceiver, which is this, like, human-looking fucking Transformer.
Keep in mind, I think what they did is they stole the Borg Queen from that Star Trek movie.
I was thinking the same thing.
Yeah.
They gave her hair, though. They stuck hair on her with this flowing, like, mechanical bullshit.
The wavy CG, we're robots kind of thing.
Yeah, so, like, here's the kick. Supposedly, long, long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, they decided to have a battle between Cybertron and Unicron. And Cybertron sent 12 knights over to Unicron to destroy it.
Mm-hmm.
Except for the knights went, fuck this shit. We're serving Unicron now.
Yeah.
And then they said, guess what? If we shut down Unicron, it can just bring back its own life cycle and people can, and something else can come from it. So the crashed ship that they were on now in Scotland has decided that it wants.
Well, no, that's the center core. Stonehenge is the center core, like, terminal for Unicron, apparently.
Yes, and it's supposed to be, it's either
so
Unicron destroys Cybertron or Cybertron destroys Unicron, but Unicron is shut down?
So there goes the storyline, the plot line, the original source material plot line, just poof. On top of that, they introduce or option 5 C-list Decepticons. They introduce new robots, I think.
Okay, that was cool just because it had a very Borderlands-esque, like, reveal.
But that was the only time that they do it.
Yeah.
Like, if they're going to do that, they need to be consistent with it all across the board. If they're going to bring out a robot and announce it in a big old flashy kind of, like, look for this in the stores, kids, kind of way, they should do that with Optimus and Megatron.
Oh,
and,
yeah, totally.
Especially because it's really difficult to even identify Megatron anymore.
And then they also did give a little bit of backstory on Bumblebee that he was, like, some VW...
He was in World War II.
And he was supposedly, like, the nastiest World War II, like...
He was, like, the most hard. Harsh, like, brutal soldier, robot soldier in the World War II for the British.
And they reveal throughout the movies that all these different robots have been in giant battles and they've done different things throughout the centuries.
To jump back, they reveal these 5 C-list, either option from the old material or just brand new Decepticon robots, do the big Borderlands reveal on them, and then they kill off 3 or 4 of them in the first fight they get into. Kill them. Chop their heads off. Like, they're in a 5-minute fight, and then they're gone.
And
you don't even show up for the rest of the movie.
Yeah, they just fucking take them out, like, right away. But they also completely waste Grimlock in this movie.
Well, they destroyed the Dinobots in the previous movie, to be fair. That's one of the reasons why I didn't see the previous movie, because the Dinobots were supposed to be these simplistic kind of bestial characters, and they still had to have some sort of context. What's the word I'm looking for? Conflict. They had to have some sort of, like, personal conflict and growth as a character. Nope, they're just giant fucking dinosaurs.
Yeah, that they're so stupid that they can't transform. Basic, they're primal.
Mm-hmm.
But in this idea, they show you, they bring back Grimlock, which is fine. That's the T-Rex, everybody, if you didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
And they bring him back, which in 4, he was the steed for Optimus Prime.
Yeah.
And that was his big point, is he was a weapon to help Optimus. And so, in the big fight at the end of the fucking movie,
he's nowhere to be seen.
They just leave him at home. They're just like, let's leave Grimlock out and leave
him
some water.
They don't even bother to say, stay here, Grimlock, or anything like that. They just say, let's get on the ship, and Grimlock just conveniently gets left out.
Yeah, and he doesn't fucking show up.
So you have this big major fight. You have all these robots you're trying to show off and merchandise, and Grimlock gets left out. Of the Decepticons you brought out, maybe 2 actually show up, and then there's Megatron. And then on top of all of that, they kill Science.
Yes, they do kill Science. Thank you for saying that.
They kill Science because one of the things they have, the MacGuffin that they have to find through the whole thing, ends up being in this ship that crash landed on Earth and ends up in the bottom of the ocean. During the course of this plot, they go from the bottom of the ocean. After activating the ship by finding the MacGuffin, it rises from the bottom of the ocean, not just to the surface of the ocean,
but 24,000 feet in the air.
Yeah, 24,000 feet in the air. and there are humans on this thing. Humans that don't immediately fall over, like, seizing and frothing at the mouth from blood, from their blood boiling or pressure bubbles showing up in their system or anything like that.
Not to mention, they also decide to, at one point, they're like, we can solve this with science and save everyone if you just give us a tactical nuke. And they go, let's do it. And then the tactical nuke does jack fucking squat.
Well, to be fair, what it does is make it harder on the heroes to actually do the heroic thing that they need to do to stop everything.
And it gives them a full reason to use zero-G technology.
Oh, yeah, so they get to show everybody kind of doing their wire-foo fly around, flip around. Oh, my God, what's going on?
You know what the fuck is going on? A bad movie.
A bad movie.
That's
a bad movie, which by that time, my eyes and my head hurt so much that I had to go home and lay in the dark for a full 2 hours. So not only did it take an hour and a half of my life to watch this movie, it took 2 hours to recover from it.
2.5 hours.
Yeah.
2.5 hours long. You didn't realize that because you were just wanting to kill people.
Yeah. By the end of it, I was getting ready. Like, we had to drive home in silence. That doesn't happen at the end of movies, all right?
We usually talk about it.
Yeah, we had to drive home in silence.
We were both sitting there just like, ow, someone stop.
Ow.
Yeah, it was bad. Yeah. You guys need to improve 3D technology. Yeah.
No. Don't leave the technology alone. Put down the camera. You are right now, you know what you are to me, Michael Bay? You are Uwe Boll with money. All right?
I would give you that, actually. There's a lot of things that Michael Bay has touched that's gone to shit. Ninja Turtles. But it's just like Ninja Turtles.
Yes, this is true. So I'm done. I say don't give this money. Don't give money to this movie. Stop buying these things. Don't go and see this. Tell the industry that this is not the kind of thing you want to see put up on the screen, but nobody's going to listen because they've already gone and seen it.
And they also want to go see explosions and the Transformers. You know what?
And the sassy British chick in a tight dress.
Right. Okay. So grab the first movie. Watch it again. Jerk off a little bit and be done with the day. Okay? Yeah. Like, because honestly, don't give the new movie any more money.
Yeah.
Have them stop. Please.
Yes.
Ah.
So that was quick and dirty reviews for Transformers 5.
Yeah.
If you like what we say here, you want to go see a movie or to say what we think about any other movie, let us know down in the contracts. That's contents. Comments. That's old movies too, not just the new stuff that's coming out. Even if it is crap, we'll go see it. Except we need to see 1,500 comments on a single video, and we will be forced to go see
My Little Pony,
the movie.
Yeah. And so last week I talked about how I've already seen the vinyl for this. The merchandise is starting to float up, mm-hmm. and it's like watching slag in molten.
Yeah.
And
it floats really up and kind of flies off the shelf.
I swear to God, if you guys make me go see it, it's going to be like the Transformers, like. And then I'm just going to, like, stop because that's going to hurt. But
otherwise,
yeah.
Like, comment, subscribe. Let us know what you think. And we will see you guys next time.
Thank you guys for coming. They had a fucking robot named Day Trader, who is a giant pile of trash. Day Trader. He's a giant pile of trash who walks around and does one piece of exposition that's like, if that was the metal, then I'm getting the fuck out of here.
Yeah.